io ne approfitto per ringraziare innanzitutto Vini, che si sta sottoponendo a un tour de force notevole. Io, da buon direttore, per anticipare i lavori, ieri ho visto già la sua conferenza e non ve l'anticipo chiaramente perché deve essere tutta una sorpresa, ma sicuramente posso dire che i temi che affronterà Vini sono i temi che noi nella nostra scuola affrontiamo e quindi sono di particolare interesse. È un punto di vista molto particolare di una persona che ha lavorato nel mondo, di una persona che ha avuto la fortuna di avere le opportunità per poter eseguire le proprie opere. Quello che ci parlerà oggi io credo che veramente interesserà a tutti e sarà motivo anche nelle prossimi giorni all'interno dei nostri corsi discutere di questi problemi. Credo che, e per questo io devo ringraziare appunto Travini, signor Adolfo Guzzini, che ci ha dato questa fiducia, questo credito nell'organizzare questo evento, a cui dopo appunto passerò la parola per un breve saluto, il comune di Ascoli che ci ha messo a disposizione questa struttura e naturalmente il Deus ex machina di tutto questo evento che è il professor Pippo Ciorra. Sicuramente senza di lui non sarebbe stato possibile fare questo. Signor Adolfo Guzzini, lascio la parola così anticipiamo i lavori. Grazie all'ordine degli architetti, a tutti gli architetti professionisti che sono venuti e se c'è anche qualche ingegnere anche a lui benvenuto in questo progetto. Siamo ecumenici. Lascio la parola.
Bene, bene, buongiorno a voi tutti, grazie per essere qui numerosi, d'altronde non poteva essere diversamente, è una grande opportunità avere con noi il grande architetto Vini Masse, che come già detto dal direttore dell'Istituto Fosco è chiaramente uno studio di architettura e una persona fondatore della stessa società che ha lavorato e lavora nel mondo, portando e approcciando l'architettura in un modo molto particolare, molto con una forza e una valenza e una un contenuto che esprime una volontà di poter aiutare il mondo a evolversi comunque, a creare nuovi spettacoli, nuove visioni, nuove funzionalità. Bene, la nostra azienda, come sapete, sponsorizza questo tipo di eventi già da 2 anni. E abbiamo una convenzione con il Maxi di Roma, Pippo Ciorra, ci conosciamo da 20 anni, però a suo modo quando eravamo bambini quasi, ma adesso ecco. E onestamente riteniamo che per il lavoro che noi facciamo e portiamo, cioè la luce alla quarta dimensione dell'architettura, ma comunque senza luce non si viverebbe e non si potrebbe neanche godere paesaggi come o città urbane come questa di Ascoli Piceno, anche se non è ancora appunto nel settore dell'illuminazione, perché l'ultimo intervento no, lascia desiderare qualcosa. Queste sono un po' critiche sparse ufficiali, ma insomma qui siamo l'Istituto dell'Architettura, pertanto dovremmo fare il meglio per il nostro territorio. La volontà di essere qui ad Ascoli, chiaramente suggerita da Pippo Ciorra, è per noi l'abbiamo fatto con molto piacere, e in quanto la sede delle grandi è quella che poi ospita col Maxi tutte le conferenze, ma vogliamo essere a disposizione del territorio per portare il massimo contributo possibile per migliorare noi tutti, perché è con la bellezza che riusciamo a rimanere competitivi nel mondo. Pertanto personaggi come Masse non possono che farci bene ascoltandolo, capendolo, intervenendo e pertanto sostenendolo. Grazie per Masse.
Allora, buongiorno, grazie a tutti di essere qui. Volevo è la prima volta che usiamo questo progetto di auditorium, speriamo che diventi presto un auditorium con le infrastrutture necessarie, per questa volta ce la siamo cavata, ma certo insomma faremo un corso sugli auditorium, secondo me, per il prossimo semestre. Io sono molto lieto di essere qui perché in genere questo progetto che facciamo, grazie alla generosità, all'attenzione e all'impegno della ditta Guzzini, di Adolfo e di Pietro Anni Cereggioli, che che è un, come dire, il Mazzarino di tutto questo, behind the stage. E però diciamo siamo riusciti a portare il progetto Lighton qui ad Ascoli, ancora più vicino ai nostri studenti. Vini ci teneva molto a parlare in una scuola e quindi questo anche ci ha aiutato a prendere questa decisione, quindi siamo molto contenti che siate qui in tanti. Siamo anche contenti sotto sotto che siamo nella settimana del Salone del Mobile, così abbiamo più studenti che professionisti. Io che poi odio il Salone del Mobile, sono felicissimo di avere qualcosa da fare qui. Lo studio NVRDV voi lo conoscete tutti, è uno studio nato all'inizio degli anni 90, condivide con alcuni dei vostri docenti il fatto che in quegli anni vinsero dei concorsi Euroban, come il professor D'Annunzio in quel periodo, poi dopo l'Olanda funziona il professor Mondaini, l'Olanda ha funzionato in modo un po' diverso dall'Italia purtroppo, sono nati da due costole diverse, lui e Jacopo Reis venivano dallo studio OMA, Nathalie De Vries veniva dallo studio Meccano, hanno cominciato a lavorare in un momento, quello degli anni 90, in cui l'architettura era molto eccitante, la condizione molto favorevole, i soldi giravano molto e il paese, cioè proprio l'Olanda come nazione, si era molto impegnata a fornire occasioni e opportunità ai suoi giovani architetti. Loro di questo hanno saputo fare un ottimo uso, hanno costruito un sacco di cose importanti, hanno, come ricordate tutti, un sacco di progetti, quello bellissimo, il Bozzocco Residence per gli anziani ad Amsterdam, uno splendido edificio per la fiera di per l'Expo di Hannover, no? Quello con i giardini, col bosco verticale, il primo bosco verticale. E poi ricordiamo il Silodam, no? Quell'edificio bellissimo sull'acqua di Amsterdam. E un altro progetto che abbiamo esposto nella mostra Recycle, che era quello, il riciclo dei silos nel porto di Copenaghen, insomma un sacco di altri progetti. Nella mostra, finalmente nella mostra Food abbiamo esposto la Martal, questo progetto che è molto famoso in questo periodo, che è questo grande mercato a Rotterdam, un mercato che sta cambiando in qualche modo il profilo della città. Con i nostri studenti quest'anno lavoriamo sui mercati, quindi siamo particolarmente contenti di avere Vini qui in persona. Raccontavo ieri a Roma che siamo stati molto addolorati con le persone che lavorano nel corso con me, di non trovare esempi italiani, no? Di nuovi mercati interessanti. Abbiamo dovuto mettere insieme spagnoli, francesi, olandesi, nordici, ma non si è trovato un progetto italiano di qualità, se non quella cagata del mercato di Testaccio, è l'unico progetto nuovo che abbiamo trovato. E quindi Vini è stato estremamente generoso ieri, loro hanno vinto moltissimi premi, hanno partecipato a molte biennali, ricordiamo un'installazione meravigliosa del padiglione olandese con le casette, che era il 2006 credo, e quindi penso che Vini è anche un docente, insegna alla facoltà di Delft, che è una facoltà con cui abbiamo legami molto stretti e a cui siamo affezionati, è stato molto generoso nella sua presentazione ieri, siamo estremamente grati that he's here today, I'm sorry to speak in Italian, but I mean, I think the best thing I can do is just shut up, relax, and the driver goes back to say, I can go and park the car. Grazie.
Thank you very much. Grazie mille. Grazie mille.
I hope the sound is okay for everybody to understand. So my Italian is very poor, so I have to do it in English. I'm very sorry for that, but I hope that we can come across. What I would like to do today is actually slightly different than Roma, because I want to, as I'm in a university here, also to take some of the, say, academic, say, scientific or pseudo-scientific parts of our enterprise. It starts with the fact that we don't build in Italy until now, and which is an interesting point of view. I think I have no clue, but still we invented something here in Italy which I would like to share with you in order to discuss actually all the things that came afterwards. You have inspired us, and you have become indeed a reference, as Sven Horas would say, Roma is the città zero, as a kind of reference for many kind of constraints, and we'll come back to that. But why do we build it then somewhere else, is a question that, of course, you are also facing sometimes. I mean, I love Torino, especially because of this image, and in that way, at those moments, when the games were over, and that you see, I mean, can't we make a building like that? I was asking. to the director of Sao Paulo, Amy, at that moment, and he invited us for a competition, and I would know in advance that Rezzo Piano would win, of course, but it's like you do it because you think, if he wins anyway, we can do what we want. So that's what we try to do, to make a project for Sao Paulo, mm-hmm. which somehow like loves this perspective, this idea that you can look over a city, that you can see the mountains and look to Roma, look further away, and to expose a back, which is normally very introverted, even Sao Paulo, is like somehow a part of the game. And how to make them there and then make them more vulnerable was actually the option that we would like to pursue. So how to do that? Because this was a question. Yeah, when you have this street here, one tower, make it next tower, is what it wants to do. Oh no, can you do that? Why two towers in this moment, in this way, in the kind of, as it happened, insane ugly way. Because you compete always with the monument of Torino, which is at that moment there. So how to deal with, what is the best combination between the monument and us, with San Paolo, Imi, and say the history. So in the first meeting with the CEO, we said, maybe we can do this. And then, so then you have a good like sister, brother. Yeah, like, and you are in the air, you're vulnerable, and you have a fantastic piazza right below in that way, and a little bit shadow in that way. This is a joke, no? No, I'm serious in that way. And I'll come back to that later in the lecture. No, you can't do that. So back to the drawing board. And they said, here, no one can see each other. Well, if I want to see the banker, I want to say hi, or I want to collaborate with it. So what we do, we opened it in the very heart. But a vertical organization, that is completely 19th century, that is not happening anymore. So we said, why can't you make a horizontal organization? Yeah, but where is my tower? He asked. I want to have a tower. So, okay, we can combine. So this is, that's the moment to do that. Yeah, but how to do that? And that's quite easy, you make better windows, also to Bologna, and also to Lyon, and then you give some columns, and that is what it wants to be. So I think if it works, it's the end. In those days, we didn't have good renderings, so it was not yet, the technology was not there. But here you see the story, I still love it, because it's kind of rough, right? To open the tower, to make it horizontal organization, because I need the end of the film, that's why I need it. To leave that, to have the view, to make these windows towards Roma and towards Frankfurt, to make columns, and to love the piazza. To make more windows to the other sides, so you can see it from everywhere. Even to the sky, but of course also from below. We need to control bankers, is this building what we say. And at that moment, when you go then down, then somehow this element, this new floating bank, loves the portico più grande, the Torino, and when it becomes the dance floor of that environment. So of course we translated into travertine, because that was demanded, and to have this kind of piazza where you could see, you could look up and be in the heart of the bankers above you, and then have this kind of, say, trading floor, where the dealers would talk with New York and with Frankfurt and with Hong Kong in that way, and have it celebrated in this best manner. What a pity we didn't get it. Excuse me, but the building that has been made is not good. And it's and I hope I can, I don't know if Renzo is in the audience, but I really want to talk with you about that. What this building wants to say is basically what's the relationship between architecture and the city. It wants to be not stupid, it wants to be somehow intelligent, it wants to push it a little bit, because then how to criticize, how to be in communication. I cannot. If you are only like silent, then you become soft, autistic, what is that, what does it make sense? To work on that. So architecture and the city have a very intense and beautiful relationship that I would like to express. Of course, that's like very old. So also we have to wonder what could be the next step in this relationship. We can talk about the next city generation and that we should engage. And yes, I love cities for many reasons. Because they are dense and they therefore create more space, they create more interaction. You are close to each other, so you can talk now with each other in that way. And it creates also more symbiosis, climatically, culturally, and economically. And but yeah, what's the next after this observation? The next step is that we want to have a kind of shopping list of desires. That's 2016 at the moment. That our cities are obviously green. That they're obviously diverse. That's why I love Europe and its open frontiers. And it should be specialistic, so that you somehow see that Roma is different than Milano, etc. Why? Because then you can encourage depth. You can go also to other cities. You love to go, and it becomes more trade in the end. So you need to be energetic, don't sleep. You need to be dense, accessible for everybody. You need to be historic. You need to be lovely and beautiful. And you need to be free. If not exciting, and in the end, of course, democratic. By nature, I'm a democratic immigrant. So how to deal that? And I want to give you three levels of, say, discussing that. Of this relationship between the building and the city. To do that on a research level, to do that on an urbanistic level, yes, urbanism still should exist. I'm aware that there are not so many urbanists on the planet, and especially there are not so very many sexy urbanists as such, that draw or that make visions in a kind of better way. So I plead enormously for education like you, that you expose yourself even better and more profound in a way. And last but not least, also some architecture for those that love architecture in the audience. So let's go for the research part. I take you to the Wine Factory. Some of you might know it. We built this tribune where we underneath the professors, on the roof, the students, so that they can talk, and then they can look, and then they can start to discuss. You have to ask questions. You have to criticize. If you don't do it, then nobody will do it. So how to train our people in that way? That they start talking and make reasoning and argumentation is, I think, a key part of our business. And of course we have to make models. Of course we have to visualize that. That's our power also. So we do that also by talking, by selling, by discussing it with our mayors and with our ministers in that way. And we produce, of course, piles of books in that way. Piles of information. It's not that high yet, don't worry. But I love that student work, even at master education level, not only PhDs, because that takes too long, 7 years almost, so to bring that together so that they can speak out. Everyone as part of, say, these researches that we do like to do. We try to make only imaginations about future cities. Yeah, you have to specialize. Every professor should do something different. And I plead for not too many professors in the world. Because, not because of competition, or losing competition, but the fact that it's better in university to have a smaller amount of professors with more assistance around it, because then you can be more deep. And you are specializing. You do something different here than in Roma or in Milano, is what I would like to propose. And I know there's a huge defense system. Eh? Professors stay there for the rest of their life, if not longer. And so what can you do? Then you splinter your observations. And I think that is very difficult in Europe that is happening. That is not happening in the medical research. That is not happening in the chemical research. Why do architecture organize itself in such a kind of splintered, stupid way? I don't understand what we are doing in that way. So we do this model, this future city in three ways. On one hand, we make a model city, simply 1 million people, and you change an abstract city, you change one parameter. Yeah? For instance, I want to have a city with wolves inside. How can I accommodate wolves? I have to open up our city in order to do that. One example, when there are sky cars involved in that way. The second element is the viewing and applying it on different situations, also with the sponsors or the political promoters that are there. And in the end, we gather it in a game, basically, in a kind of interactive momentum. The controller starts now in August. This complete, say, work of this parameterized instrument as the best archive that I can imagine, beyond the books. So to give you some ideas of some of the researchers, I'm not going into more of them. This comes out very soon. This is a trailer for a moment, to buy it in the future, because Now with this copy guide, you can really copy everybody better, and then you can improve, you can all become masters in an easy way, is what this book is going to say. This is how we do it for the Netherlands at the moment, what it should do with this headlines, but what's next. I take you to three researches for a moment. One is, of course, that everyone wants to believe that we should be green. No problem about it. This book was mentioning like many observations on greeners. I'm not going into that because it's that's for reading. But it proposed also a calculator. I come back to that later because that is now applied in some of the cities, in a way. A calculator that is multilingual, that is not only Neat and Brea, but also five-star system in one go, so that you can communicate with each other and you can calculate the greenest city. So we did that, and this is the greenest city on the planet. It's better than Mostar. But it looks quite boring, no? It's like, this is really Dutch, you could say. And so what to do about that? So this series of, say, collaborations with patent holders is what we do with many universities now to extend that product, to make it even better, that product, and to give it an urbanistic meaning. That's all. So what can I show? For instance, this one. This is a section of a crop rotator. So, say when you produce salad and you do it like this, then you have a better, more efficiency. You can bring that up to somehow, for the moment, to 2 meters high. So what we try to do to make it 20 meters high, because to create more efficiency in that way, and with another kind of speed. And then try to apply it over our roofs in that way. And so we propose it, of course, for Barcelona, because then you have a nice green city, of course, and then we get rid of this kind of Gaudi obsession. Another product, this is concrete that loves water, that in a way harvests water, harvests the dew that is there, that can happen around the concrete. This is a very nice product. If you actually do that in tropical circumstances, tropical circumstances, you can collect them enormously. So this is a proposal for Cairo to imagine new pyramids of water, basically, that is in that way, and that beat with Giza in the best way. What is fun? In this water, you can see it here, there are different levels of microbes. Microbes can be activated, some of them, through electricity. Put some electricity in the water and they start to glow. That's gorgeous, because what happened in that case? Then the Amsterdam looks really beautiful in that way. And we don't need our lanterns anymore. And it feels, I want to swim in Amsterdam, almost. That is what I wanted to say. So that's another test that we're doing. And this one is under production. The students that did that are, yes, they have a nice patent again. So they it's basically collecting solar power, but then putting it into a device that turns and that finds the best, say, composition. So they worked it out in that way, and then they made this kind of images that went over the planet. And suddenly this kind of water lilies become like beautiful. They touch this kind of avatar feeling, and they it becomes, that is nice that now in Phuket and in Hong Kong, that they want this, and they want to test with that, and to have this in front of the bay. Suddenly, with architecture becomes sexy, it accelerates greenness, it goes beyond the boredom of data, but it uses the data in a way to make it believable as such. So what is next? I take you to the Paris city, because some of you might have visited the Biennale in Venezia where we showed this, but I want to explain it as a method to encourage research in that way. And I show you the latest standard of the art. So what is happening? These are towers. Most of these towers are ugly, to be honest. They are stupid, they are autistic, as I said before. If they go in, up, and out again. They don't do anything for the city. They don't do anything for the collective, as such. So what we're investigating, if you have a tower like this, and you open it slightly, what does this opening act mean? Opening a tower means, basically, it becomes more porous. It gives place for vegetation. It gives place for the collective, for talking, for access, and for cooling. In the end, for ventilation. So how can we work with that in that way? How far can we go and what motives can we do? So we made this film. Where every, say, group of students worked on one step. One started the tower, and you open it in the middle, like this pregnant woman, basically, that we can see, to create a collective. And every step calculates how much it costs in money, in place, and in validation. Here the twister, how it would look like, or this the group twister, how we can imagine, or the ones that make neighborhoods with this, with openings in the very middle. Or this here, the cactus maker, that starts to split towers so that they become different safe views between the people. So every step by step is a sequence. From this, it's more Italian, then to this one, we can imagine so different say, ways and motives to do that. And here, of course, this student was fired afterwards. So you have different kind of, say, examples. That leads to series, from zero to maximum of balconies, from zero tower to opening it up in the bowl series, to maximize, say, all these kind of, say, balconies or bay windows that we could imagine, to deviate our towers, to turn it into landscapes, to turn it into parasites. And we could create maybe this plan of making this army of towers with the flip book on the left and the army before us. And that we could be then shown and travel over the world. Now, if I go then deeper into that, then I see, I always dream, I said it yesterday also, if we had a Wall Street would look like this, if Manhattan would look like this, it would be more scientific, because it's like series of elements, it would be more beautiful and more, here you see the lineup of the pregnant towers in that way, you see the views through the ball series from nothing to collective, to flat, the parasites, how they grow over it, the neighborhoods. Yeah, this is a nice one. And I know, this will be copied in a while. Because you can, terrace by terrace, you can walk from the bottom to the top. And then, of course, for the balance, you need to go back. But, of course, it's a tower that would be very polite. I mean, I dream to position this, of course, opposite the Bosco Vaticano. So to have then a very polite way of saying that I have a lovely colleague in that way, and also to have the forest over there, etc. So here you can see the different examples of what kind of city, even Frankfurt Wright is in it, that turns into this. So what's the next step after that? I'm trying to go from one extreme to the next extreme, because every extreme, and you solve it, you're done with it, you have knowledge, but it poses immediately the next question. It's like what I call the series of research. And that, how can I do in this case? We had, with that series, we had a post-scripting. And how can we do with a pre-scripting environment? How are you invent the rules and the relationships before it? So you see that happen. For instance, with the stairs option, they have this kind of, say, parameters. You connect them, as you do also here in the school, with your grasshoppers. And then you start to invent what that will be. You connect the points like this, you combine it with the housing units, in this case, and then you have stairs. And if you do that in an optimized way, with structure, then I get a tower which is more beautiful than any Escher drawing, in a way. And that somehow would be lovely to make, that is open, that is porous, and it wants to generate collectiveness in that way, and beyond that. Or when you want to make landscapes. So the same parameters, you start with floors, with landscapes, start to connect them with them and use program for that in the same manner. And then I get this. Then I get towers where I have grottos, and grottos connect with the other grottos in that way. And you can, here you see the ceilings and how it goes down to this tribune feeling, and that they become also not stable again in the way what it wants to see. I would dream about such a tower somewhere in that way. This was student work, which was top. And then you can continue. There are many descriptors, many exercises that we made in order to make this, and then again to compare them with each other and to show it to the world. These are sculptures, and there's pseudoscience in it. I'm aware, it's not complete science. So the book will tell you more if we do that also with structure, how much steel is involved now, how much air is involved, and will come out in a couple of, months or so. Of course, we cannot go on with that. Eh? So here you see a test, of course, that we, because if for one tower, I need 3 students for 3 weeks, 24 hours a day, to make it. It's impossible. So this guy is doing it now, and that makes it then in the end better to, it's also more European, I would say. So, of course, that means that basically our work, or our, is this what you're doing? Some of you are doing it, I saw it downstairs in your labs, to work, and it's quite easy to do. So please buy a robot here next time, and a couple of them to do that in a way. This one was, don't worry, it's easy. Eh? After the film Gravity in LA, they didn't use it anymore. And so we could use it now easily with a couple of universities tools to get these things done. You see it with Gravelin, how we're doing that. So what's next? This is a sequence of, say, what I call the porosity factor. And that is somehow what we learned in Torino, and then somehow abstractized. That's what it wants to say. So there is a ping-pong game between reality and say, abstraction as such. But now, I'll show you something weird, maybe. Maybe not.
Here it is, in a minute. Barbara. I love Barbara at the moment.
Why? Barbara's a beard, of course, but it's like the poster was showing. But it's something about Barbara Papa and Barbara Mama. So, I start with Barbara Papa. Barbara Papa is this book, and it is basically this. It is what we do with Axel Nobel and Basef, is to use rubber that can electronically change. And that can change its density, this rubber. So you make it for hearts, artificial hearts. So if you do that, you can thicken it from structure, or you can open it and it becomes a vessel to wash your hands in that way. Or it can take light even through it in the future. You have to make it. And you can make furniture below. And of course, it's fantastic that the neighbor below has a cupola at that moment. So and if you thinner it even more, it becomes, that was the dream. Of course, there's a logic behind it. Am I watching television and my wife comes at home, then we would do it together. And this sequence shows how much space I need. I take a shower in the morning, then we go then at the same moment away. There we go. We don't need the rest of the house. The house can shrink. It's stupid to keep this kind of big, ugly monsters everywhere in our periphery. And even then the offices, of course, that are empty, can you go, okay, there's one guy working, we can make it, we can start to work together. So there's a sequence of, say, a space that we should evaluate. And this book tries to calculate how much waste of space we have in our attempt to densify. This, I think, is the next step to organize ourselves. And it's not only us, it's also our neighbors in that way, how they are dealing with that. So here you see how neighbors react in this primitive, say, collage to see what could happen. And there's a moment that I love in this sequence, in this film, is saying when you see here all the neighbors happening, and then this happens. There. 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 What happens here? Is that possible that I make an apartment building where things go through? You have to compare it when you go to IKEA and you throw your kid in this ball zone. Now there's balls there and other kids are there, and you boom, the other kids don't feel it. It goes like it dampens out, is what its material is doing. So there's much more flexibility than I thought before. So what's next? And then we asked, say, because we made a sequence of this element, and this is the what we call the questionnaire film. Of course, it's a contribution to one of the nicest filmmakers in the 30s, that's clear. So you have a body, you have a person, and he sleeps. How much space does he need? So we make this film on top of it. Claustrophobia? Yes, I know. Don't worry, we'll come back to that. So he wakes up. He needs more space to go around. He wants to view. And the material pushes him up, like Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times. Oops, there it is. And he stands and starts to walk. So that is what we ask from Basef. Can you make that material doing that? Our software engineers have to do that. You know? This is also nice. How much space do I need before myself? And when can I leave the space behind, is what this question is. I will show you the research about what happened afterwards in this case. Or when I look up, how fast does it accommodate to internal views in that respect? Of course I want to have light, that's clear. And how to make light is my question, of course, to you. I love that we could stand like this in that way, and there would be different patterns of light, is what we dream about. That you can come in. That is how things could adapt. So we have to find something that we can direct through voice, or through our movement, to make this movement possible. He works for it. I thank you. So every student makes money. His student loves his son. Was clear. But the moment's fantastic when these things match. How can I make material that matches open itself in a fraction? is what it doable. The electronically we can do that. Oh, this one is fantastic, because water comes like this to you where you want. You wash your hair and wherever you want. So I don't need pipes anymore, because the material does it themselves. And of course it can gather and you can swim wherever you want, is what it wants to say. And here it goes to a direction. I want to show this part because it has an interesting, say, philosophical consequence at the moment if you do that. So here, swimming and swimming and swimming, he gets light, no problem. Take you to the section. So the question is, what is here moving? Am I moving? Or is the city moving? Is what the question. So there is a moment, if this happens, that place has another definition in the vocabulary. He needs to shit, so he goes away. Water goes up, then we make, of course, a shower. That's better than Peter Zumthor's one in vowels, and that would be much more beautiful. Oh, this is also, this is budget with the bigger pairs, where we tried out to imagine also clothes with that. If you can do the same, I can do any type of clothes. Jeans, no problem. Gucci, no problem in that way. And that comes to you, and you pick it up. And the film is not complete in that way, but the next step we do that is that it comes to you. Of course, I don't have to do this anymore, but I hate that in the morning. So, and that is what it starts to accommodate. So you can continue, this by question. What should that material do? I want to show you one element, so, because that is with our chef cooks, that is one. So also, stuff comes to you, bananas, spaghetti, but the heating up, collecting water, and then boiling this water will be fantastic in that way. That will be the best restaurant. Sicilian, no problem in that way. We can pre-arrange that and come to you in this connection, and we get a different view for that. Watch it further on YouTube, and you can see that. But this is the start for another research. So I show you how, for instance, PhDs are working on this Muybridge captures, which basically starts to analyze how much space I need. And there are certain volumes. So you have a volume, you have a space, and you try to calculate how much space, how long do you keep it behind you in that way. And you mirror it to the front, so that you know how much you need before you. In that. That's basically the concept of this movement study as such. And that is the next step in our Muybridge. But what's next? I think this one is nice also. So we start at the moment. I'm happy to announce that we have some budget for that also. With what you call the magic carpet, with Vitra. So you have basically filled with chicken wire in between. And then you can indicate with some motors, not with, as a test, to see what the carpet can do. And then you can, oh, it can become a table to hang out. This is a critical moment. Or to sit on it. How much stuff do I need to make that stable? Is what this test the coming year is going to do. And I can lie down, etc. No problem. This is a dream that I would like to realize the coming. And it takes a hell of an effort to make all these motors doable and to get this magic carpet over there. And then I can start to work, of course, on rooms like this. And here's some images of what a felt room could be like to start with. And what, of course, is needed is to activate this felt. So here, the first test, paid by a Swedish lady, she's 85 years, has a castle next to Gripsholm, and said, I want to pay you some of this. I want to have that in the house. So this is the napkins for her dinner. So when there's a dinner there, the other napkin reacts to you. And you communicate on the table with each other in that way. Why? It's a matter how action and reaction is going. Is what we could test with this case. Then I go further in that way to the talking wall, same castle. And so how can we then also make the vertical component in it? So there are different tests, I'm not going to show them all. They're based on a very simple technology to start with, sound wave activation. And there's nice patterns of user voices. These are the specs behind it, so you can make it. That's what I want to say. There's some great low tech. It's the new stuff that you can find. So here we have our PhD again, one of them. He's nice. He starts nice, of course. He loves his wall. And he's thinking, okay, start with communication, and the wall reacts in that way. He's not happy with the reaction. You start to yell, the wall becomes angry in this case, and start to protest against that. So we could pre-script all this
Of course, is this now hell or is this beauty? Is a question that we could discuss. But it's there, even though the ones that are against are loose, because the anime will be happening, is what we said to show. So, you go on. Coming here, Barbara Papa House, and of course, where is Barbara Mama in that way? So what is next? This is only rubber. So we need also plants to be, and birds to be in it. So we just start in the Floriade lab, this idea how we can make strata of, say, biodegradable stuff, and that produces biomass, also in the same flexible way. So that's what it is. And it's every time one hypothesis, every time the next step, and every time a future is what this new city could be. And indeed, nightmare or dream, I suppose, is then a question, but it creates knowledge, step by step, in that relationship between architecture and between the city. Now I take you to the next step, chapter. I take you to urbanism. Because, yeah, that to defend that urbanism is cool in that way. And there are people, and maybe the next show, the Maxi will say urbanism is shit, but it's the Japanese people are very desperate on it. But I do agree that there is a role to play for you here in this environment. Let me say, what can we talk about the larger scale? And we have Europe, and I love Europe. That's why we are here. Europe is nice also because of this. It has incredible amount of towns, small towns of 100. They have incredible amount of history, sometimes maybe too much in a way. And that's what and mayors love this. And they love to be to have a castle, to have some cute houses. That is what they. But they want also that you walk in those cities. That's sure. They also love that you have a metro line. I mean, even in small cities at the moment, we want that metro lines. Or tram lines. So this is super hot. Everywhere tram lines in Europe at the moment. And that you bike. So that is nice, that we try to add things to our agenda. But on the other hand, this is our world for 60% in Europe. There's a tremendous amount of shit again that has been produced. And also Italy has a lot of it, to be honest. And we call it the lilification of Europe. So that you have gradually, cheapness is everywhere, and how to deal with that is, and how to combine that with that metro line, in a way. You see the results at the moment, that our inner cities are extremely expensive, and very worth, and on the other side, these peripheries are extremely poor, and this bifurcation is happening more, stronger than I thought over the last years. So there's work to do in order to balance that. So we need politicians, I hope there are a lot in the room here, to talk with each other. Architecture is political, no problem. And I think urbanism is political. But why not? Why are we afraid of politics? Why are we talking only about autonomy of architecture? Only about transparency? Only about mystical sources? About complexity and about other kinds of zones? And contradictions, of course. So let's do something also in more actively on that agenda, is what we would like to propose. Funnily, if you go to the US, which has this kind of urbanism, which I, oh, this is really awful, all the streets in the US end in cul-de-sacs, is what I'm saying. The urbanism in America is an urbanism of dead ends. So that is, okay, but now they gradually make this. They make this in Los Angeles. What is happening over there? Is what we see. Another one, what happens in Asia, which is based on rawness and all about infrastructure. And if I go to Nagasaki, I see this. It's not Amsterdam. If I go to Shanghai, then I'm biking through Copenhagen, almost. Or I'm visiting Germany at that moment. So there is an incredible, say, love for Europe in happening. So we have something by tradition, by awareness, qualities that somehow are not so bad in that way, and that we could use to make our cities better, and those of them also. So we have a market, basically. You, with your knowledge, go to Shenzhen and transform Shenzhen, is what it wants to say. So what's next in that way? Of course you know this project in Paris, where we worked with that, our client in Hollande at this very moment on Greater Paris. I show it because I think it's still a nice project to show. And it's continuing. It takes a long time, 8 years ago. And now, I show the consequences a little bit. Because we think Paris is beautiful, it is, but 90% is, it's like Milano, it's like, and this kind of, you don't want to, and you see the problems at the moment with the fights in the banlieue, and so there's something to do over there.
So we address this, look, how to make an agenda for our architecture by referring to Kyoto, by calculating how much space we need that on the planet, by advocating not that you should go do less, you should do more in order to activate this process and this progress in a way. So that is what it wants to say, and we give the first cadeau, a gift to Sarkozy was a calculator. It's not very romantic, I'm aware, but it really shows how he could think about the performances of his city. So, which was striking to see, because density in Greater Paris is super low, lower than Berlin. Tourism is okay because of Versailles and because of Disney, but the density of work is again super low. Poverty is there in that way. And then it's interesting to see, because the public transport is not bad in Greater Paris, but still they don't use it. Only half of the population use it. The rest drives cars. It's the same ratio as in Los Angeles that we are facing. And that was shocking to aware. So if you say, how good are you? Then you get this map. So good points and extremely weak points. If you compare that with other kind of cute cities of Europe or further away, that creates an agenda, a program. I want to improve that, how to do that. It gives an argument for you as architects to draw something which makes sense in that way. So here we calculated what to do in 20 years. So we need something like this amount of forests and water development to compensate the oxygen loss. We need this energy, this amount for the roads, etc., for habitats, for economy. This is my second gift to Sarkozy. Please, take it. And now, open the box and then do something with it. So I'm happy to announce that currently this National Forest of Grand Paris is under production on the southwest side, beyond the Saclay Plateau. So that is a nice effort. I love that project as such, how it can happen. The second one is the energy project, two laws. One, to concentrate windmills on the Plateau de Saclay, which becomes a monument of air at that moment. And secondly, the law that says that every roof has to be covered by solar panels. It's very easy, this law. It takes you an hour to make a letter and to go to bring it to the parliament. But it is nice because that transforms all the roofs of Paris into this kind of black sea of panels like that. Of course, infrastructure is still an investment. And I come back to that, how to pay that. One of the projects that we are working on is this stupidity. All the trains end in Paris. Gare du Nord, Gare d'Austerlitz, Gare de Lyon, and then go to a taxi, an hour and a half through traffic, go to the next train. How can they do that? Of course, it's the center of the world, so you can allow for that. It's how Paris behaves. So this simple project to make it into connections and to avoid a level cable, the traffic around it, is basically what we're trying to do. How to make that, how to calculate, how much does it cost to make this connection and to make a new Grand Gare dans la Place de la République, evidently. The most important symbol, as has been shown recently in this terrible accident in Paris. That should be also the place to meet, to where the periphery comes up and where we all start to share each other. That's the Grand Carrefour de l'Europe. Evidently, that could be there, is what we try to do. And then we go further. Of course, the banlieue should be not this, but something like that, so that we can indeed create a more... But also, Houston should be solidaire. The poor guy from the past, he should somehow get one extra story on top of it. Just 5 meters, I can make new solar panels, but this creates so much tax value, so incredible, that I can sponsor 2 metro lines to be paid with that. So this simple act. And you do it in a very egalitarian way, so no one can be against. That is what this project is doing, and Anne Hidalgo is pursuing with this. So there's a list of projects that you could do. And if you bring them all together, all based on this kind of, some, on this kind of logics of the new cities, then I make this is my new map of Paris. These are all opportunities to do that. And then actually, what I do is too much. It becomes better than the target. So we can only use half. Already. So Paris, instead of plus grand, deviendra plus petit. That's what we try to do. And this is the score, and here how this Paris plus petit project in the end could be good. So big through smallness is a smart technology. We know that. There are a lot of people that use that strategy to do that. But you need both, otherwise you become solitude and you don't know what you're doing, is what this project is saying. So what's next? And I'm happy that we bring you to Bordeaux, and how urban planners have to be among people. That's what you do, basically. You bike around, talk with everyone. Oh, passe comme ça. No. Okay, now where is this? It's that side. It's the other side of Bordeaux that we are treating. Bordeaux is bobo, eh? It's cute. So you go there, nice, and go to the river, you know, cute. UNESCO on one side, shit on the other side. So you see that Napoleon left there, cute buildings, horrible 80s and 90s and zeros in that way, and how to deal with that. So an operation like this, we plan this eight ZACs, these zones, that somehow conquer the La Rivoite, the third line. And that changes from this into this, I'm aware. So you could have said maybe it should be completely different. Bordeaux decided to copy itself. I think it's nice. You can't do that in other places in that way. So how to do that? By being intense, by loving the history, by being mixed, and by being, this was the crucial factor, be a team. Is that possible? What is the goodness about intimacy, is a question that an urbanist can ask. Because you're close, so you can immediately react on me, if I can do that, is what it says. Of course, there's many laws that are against that. You want to be green also, so be green in between us, in that way. There's a place needed for energy, for connections, but also for light. I show the consequences of that paradox. So here, the first part. This is how we make the new Passerelle, together with an artist, nice. But that's not the issue here, too. There's a lot. So, there are rails, there's Napoleon, there's the SNCF. We say we don't choose. We love them all. What monument is better? Can you give me a definition? And you, as Italians, you are the masters of monuments. You conquer UNESCO with everything. I work for UNESCO, but with about 90% of Italian architects and engineers to calculate that. Anyway, so let's keep everything, build on top of it, don't worry. Then make a road around it, 6 meters wide. That's enough. Perfect. And then you can build the rest. Okay, with what? So this is our new, say, pavement. 50% of ruelle, shared space, to make that, and that, yeah, it looks a bit like that. Anyway, it's not bad, and funny, and they love it over there. So here you can see that adds this kind of Amsterdam feeling, so that you live on the ground floor, is what it wants to say. So how to do that? One consequence is that the tramways actually split. Normally you go like this, but no, you can't do that, you have to put it like this. I have to change the French law for that. Because it's by traffic engineering divided. Took a long time, but done. So then we can make the buildings. Ah, this is too high. And then we go to shave these buildings. 45 degree angle for some to live on the ground floor. Looks like that. Ah! The nicest shapes I've ever seen suddenly come appear by azar, by coincidence in a way. And even if we do a lower angle because of Bordeaux, then it shaves it even more, and then we start to contextualize, get some extra streets in it, and the pocket parks, and have 150 architects working on it. That is what it wants to be. Okay, then we have to open our courtyards because of ventilation. We add solar panels, green on the roofs, water systems that are absorbed by the roofs in the same moment, and that's it. And now, yeah, everyone can build. You can do what you want inside. As long as you do this, that's all what it does. So you see it happening, how you extrude, how you cut it, shave it more, and how all the treatments are leading to this kind of, say, sequence, and ultimately you have this, more or less. And if I do it on this side, same thing. And then we show how it's going to be in Bordeaux, how on the other side this will come now, with these, the roof scapes that are there, that are surprisingly, and maybe even competitive with Roma in that way, and that somehow wants to be small, you see the scale, and intense, and lightful. That's what it wants to be. And of course, this passerelle is nice. You always can put it up, and you can forget La Rivoite if it doesn't want to be part of Bordeaux, if that is the case. It's, of course, a symbol of that operation. So what is next? Two urban agendas is what I showed today.
I take you to Amsterdam to give you another kind of agenda and how it translates into our architecture. And this is again a contribution to Stefano about a city next to Amsterdam, which is super poor. All the poor people were moved to the city in a new town for this kind of production. And you hate it at the moment that you see it. And it's so what to do with this stuff? The people bought it just 10 years ago. You can't touch that in a moment. So we have to act, and it's a plan, like yeah, also you have been doing, garden cities. That can be nice, living in green, but the green is extremely dangerous. You don't dare, as a woman, to go through this jungle around it. So we have to do something about that in order to do that. And then we accepted it, because I think it's also very specific. It's different than Amsterdam, it's different than Rotterdam, and you can do work with it. So we work on Omiale 2.0. So this is all the development of the garden cities that are there, and we add 5 of them. And we move, say, the old diagram of Howard into this. More connectivity, more differentiation is basically what you're trying to do. So you control each other in that way. How to do that with the existing matter? We make, basically, we don't touch the existing, we only make new things in between, is what it's going to do. How to understand that? One lateral line that connects 5 garden cities. That's nice, because now we can make 5 new garden cities. Well, what's the relationship between the word garden and city? What kind of architecture comes out of it? This is the line from Amsterdam, comes up here, and then it goes through and it cuts through the different compartments. This is the first stop in that trajectory. And it is basically in a lake which, as I explained yesterday, also looks like coffee. It's brown, it's dark, it's terrible. It's not pristine at all. So how to clean this stuff? It was a hydrological problem, clearly. So we make a big pit, we make a hoover that gets rid of all the chalk. I will not go into the technical details, though it's nice. It's invisible. And then clean it with our city, with our 20,000 houses, and surround it with reed. There it appears. I like to plant this in this area. We learned from Italy. We learned from Venice. Venice could have been also somehow using its laguna also in another way, what it wants to say, instead of dams. We could have swamped the dams. A complex situation. And I had already too late, of course, in Venice. But somehow we tried to learn from them. The next stop, we go further. Make an expo of housing to invite Amsterdammers, richer people to come. We go to the city center and we make on the, around this lake an extension with a new green, say, hill that makes a kind of extension of the university and of the city center. And we end maybe in this area, which I showed in the last Biennale with the Freeland film, where we now it's agriculture and we combine it with housing in a kind of free way. That's what wants to go to do. So what's next? I only give you one example of that. Because that is what's happening now, in the very moment, on here the Floriade. It is on this spot. It is one, okay? It is a comment on the Milano World Expo, to be honest. And so, again, a reference. Thank you very much, Italy, for giving me this opportunity to do that. And because what can we learn? This is an expo on flowers. And that's happening every day in the Netherlands, and you can do something with that. So this spot, what to do? So here, on the left side, my city, on the right side, Ramp City, Almere Centrum. So here, a battle of generations is going to happen, and it looks like this. I look to OMA, plan like this, and this skyline. Nicely built, no comments, honestly very well done. But I'm asking if, when I'm on Rem's plan, I look to the other side, I can see this is the basically what to do. How to do that? This next step in greenness. Here's the urban plan that we made, just a handkerchief that demonstrates in a maybe brutal, but in also an autonomous way, yes, what we can do. It wants to be scientific, so that's why the Floriade lab that starts now is important, that to understand the relationship between plant and human being, between animal and human being. Up to now, we design only products for about 0.2% of ourselves, only for us. There are 99% others around us, like these animals and plants, like the bacteria, that deserves design and attention. So we try to do that, and we can do that with tulips, we can do that with wisterias, we can do it with ivy. This is a very nice building.
You can do it with birch trees, bamboo, tomatoes, and yes, we use some of our fantastic ancestors to make that possible. How to do that? So there will be a landscape architect, there will be an architect and an artist working on it. Every spot, 1,000 plots. You get a species, you choose Forsythia, you get it. And you can make a building, and you add some healthy systems and the path, and that's it. So what happens then? You get this composition of difference that is all happening. So where indeed the Belgian pavilion will do something different. And every pavilion will stay. Well, we don't want to have tents that go away. Italy, you are going to make a house for Dutch people afterwards. They buy that crazy house of you in that way. And that house will be placed in a specific section. So we dream this combination of program and plants. A good sports hall look like this. A good training center and a good discotheque can look like that. You sleep, of course, in a very good Dutch way. And you have bath in green. And you can do that in many ways. That's what we try to curate. And then to manipulate this curation so that it forms the city as such. With mini plots, 20 by 30 meter only. And you can make what you want inside, as long that I only see the interpretation of that plant. And I cover your architecture with your plants. Don't worry, there's no discussion about architecture at that moment. So that's also done at that moment. This is how we cut out the existing and how it is. This is the plan of this city, 65 hectares. And these are all the clients, all the species. And they all get a betula, you know, brassica. We treat them as a kind of beauty, as such. And we place them alphabetically, of course, how to do it differently. From A to Z, from Azalea to Zenobia, will be at that moment placed. Of course, the Italian section is under the I plants, and Belgium is under the B. But anyway, you get Belgium, get the Berbers, which fits perfectly with them in that way. And then this is the buildings that we are making. These are the streets that are appearing. This is the skyline that I promised to you. And here are the buildings again on the boulevard that will be over there and how it will be shown to the world as such. How the model is made, how it travels down with the canals through in the marina, the mini streets, the campsite, the grottos, and the people that are working on it is what he wants to say. So here, yes, you can make it. Oh, why Milano didn't do it like that? Why it has led to this stupid food court that you have given to the world? Why was there almost nothing to see? And was it still so successful? It's one of the biggest mysteries that I've seen this last year on the planet. Let me go further. Well, I bring you now to Asia in that way. And to show you, say what's happening over there. In a couple of ways, to see where it is. We are asked to make in the Museum of Tomorrow a next step after what this person did. And we should relate ourselves to the city for another statement than 101. So what's next? This is the site. And if you make the X-ray of the site, you see individual practices. It's quite nice, this X-ray. So, and it's somehow a comment of an urban development which is happening now over there. You can see that in this demonstration, one guy lived in a nice house, nice neighborhood, but it's kind of, these monsters are going to happen now. And they're passing by in Southeast Asia with millions at the moment, with an horror that I cannot imagine, which is beyond any corner, you have some gold there in it. But this is the issue. How can we deal with that? And if you go there, again, this couple looking to diversity, what is now my thing? Type A, type B, type C? And that at the moment that there are many companies much smarter dealing with diversity in that way, we could learn. So how to do that? Giving maybe more types of housing. This is a normal one, a classical one, one with a tower, one a twin set, a hip one, a factory, even hipper, a Catholic one, a bar, a courtyard house, a runaround. Yeah, it can go up. You can create it, of course, with material, with landscapes, with more fences. If you then start to make that list, then you have choices on different scales. And it was nice to see the first, say, choices of, say, about 20 people that choose these. Okay, fine, fair. And then you have quite a cool block, I would say, where you can walk around, and it's which is a vertical village, as we call. And it's also a comment maybe to Herzog & Lübbenau, to Vitra, which is very beautiful, but it's a One building, this is urbanism. So this is another urbanism again, is very important to imagine. So what's next? We waited for 2 years, we did some research further, and now with 50 people, it's going to be this. So this is nice because now you see also the environment, the block attack has also appeared over there. This is the contrast, and this is the dream that we would like to pursue in that building. So what's next? In Jakarta at the moment, similar enterprise, one could say. Here you can see the images of the newspaper, and what is it here? And this is Jakarta, it's flat. Kampungs, villages everywhere. Beautiful social entities, to be honest. You walk on the street, there are cows, there's everyone you can meet. But traffic-wise, horrible. And of course, hygiene-wise, intensely problematic. So it's good that they investigate intensification by new metro lines. And that causes like moments of intensification. How to do that? If with this first intensification, what does the president like? And yes, something that is not like the twin towers of Petronas in Kuala Lumpur. Of course not. Should not look like that. So how to build up a rhetoric for him is what he wants to say. There's also a place of this Rupia factory, and the surrounding looks like this. All these kind of blocks that are there, 2, 3, 4 stories high. So what we try to do, basically, with the same typology, we blend them together with jewelry to make it a tower. That's all. So how to do that? How can in a cheap economy you could do this? This is what it wants to say. It's not so complicated. This is the site. This is the pavement you need to keep. This is the fire, the program. You dig out. You put a parking with an entrance to the metro. You add your retail basement. You make blocks out of the new retail. Put it in between. Put some extra retail on top. Do it the same with the entertainment blocks of all the cinemas by MGM. Block like this and get rid of all the same housing by different neighborhoods you want to see. Add some office blocks and top it up with a Marriott hotel. So that's all what you need to do. And then suddenly, of course, you can cover it with green. You have more roofs, that's crucial. I tell you why. Because they come back to that, they have to cool the building. You would wonder why can you build that or is it possible? So the client said maximum 10% of steel. Oh, the problem is maybe not so big. It's only one high rise and the rest is mid rise. Okay. Second analysis. We can only make 4 towers, what it says. So we can do it easily. But this is the bridge structures. Okay, 10%. Well, let's see. And the guy levers and the smaller ones. And then this is built out of super corks, surrounded with super corks in a way. And then add this steel to it. And that's it. And that's why it's not possible, even in that kind of circumstance. There is a difference because of program and different facades to that. That's okay, like that, treated in different manners. And with all the treatments of the, it causes a self-shading, which in that kind of circumstance is quite, as you know, also important. And the creation of this vertical jungle with the water retention causes a kind of airflow, which we can avoid an internal mall. Because that would be, of course, horrible to get that and to look at it. And then we have this micro. We make some destinations in it, and then this is the building. Well, that's all. Here that you can walk around from the bottom to the top, over the cinemas to the Soho block on that area, to the Sawa block on that side, and then it blends in as a steep hang of building program on this area. And it tries to summarize the city. It tries to turn it into energy and make it a symbol of that act, is what it wants to say. I think you took Beijing for a moment. The latest project that we are doing. To another site and to show you that also even here it's good to think about Asia. Because when I arrived I told the people, should I show this? But yes it should. Because it's good that we all think about the global aspects and we can learn from them. It's next to Tiananmen Square, Mao was there here on the other side, and they have this what we call Hutong over there. And it looks like that. It's quite cute. But it's a ruin, kept for ages to be waiting for development. So what can we do with that area? So the Hutongs were beautiful. When your filmmakers made these gorgeous films over there, and based on it, became this kind of traditions came out of it, is what we know. Now there's a decay, as I said before, by this kind of monster. There's a comeback at the moment, where Disneyfication is taking over in a gigantic manner after the Olympic Games in Beijing and in Shanghai on this kind of elements. They are going on with this kind of copycats to make this kind of structure. And this is hilarious. You see the block attack and the repair, and they remake the hutongs before it. So, okay, what's next? It's good to think about new urban neighborhoods. But new urban neighborhoods are quite cool. And they generate new economies, like this one in Seoul, this one in Paris, this one in New York, or this one in Amsterdam. So based on that, we can learn from that, as Saskia Sassen is already predicting in one of her books 10 years ago. So why not continue on that? So this is what happened in the last 10 years on that site. They cut through it, they added blocks, and we were working on different hypotheses to imagine how to make more density in this area. High rises. Here's the hutong, and put high rises below, and you lift the whole hutong up. If it looks like this, there's your hutong. Or combine it with a slope so that you have the hutong and put it on top of a mall, like this. Not bad. Or you dig it in, and you have, say, basically glass streets where you can look down into the mall. Or here we learn again from Italy, yeah, to turn it into the Foro Romano of Beijing by allowing it for simply ruinification in a beautiful way. Could it be? Your Foro Romano delivers more money than an intense area in New York. So, but they didn't choose for this. So that would, and or to do more with all people. This is a new law in China, of course, to do a magic variety. They came up with a, actually they loved that last one, they said, can you combine it with intensity? Yeah. So we make a series of projects at the moment, a choreography. What's urbanism? You come up with a kind of idea now, what makes sense, but not to keep the structure of the hutong, but to let it be interpreted in a rich way. 1700 courtyard houses. So you, some of them, they are simple preservation. Of course you start with that, but then you have done that. And that's so the series of projects look like that. Fine. You also make space for interpretation. Because I think history is not only, it's also something that we could interpret in different ways. And I'll show you some examples in the future. You're a printed house in the same way that we do in Skyville. Or the communication project, where we use it for advertisement. And here a shop by Jensen, how it would look like if we mirrorize completely one of the houses. Or the green projects, how they contribute with the gardens to the environment, how the river project could be made, there it is, and the houses somehow illustrate how you could live with that in the hutongs, but then in glass. The Passage project, where you extend the shopping into one piece, like with this kind of environment, that you cut through the hutongs, suddenly you have advertisements. Of course, we need to densify it here and there in different ways, by stacking it, by flipping it, by, this is a very beautiful one, to advertise basically that I'm there. Or the deeper project, where we dig into it, which looks like this. The parking project, my favorite somehow, because yes, we can do it in different ways. You can see it here. I love the one on the, that one here. You go in, then the house goes up and the house goes down. So it is a, and the amenities, of course. We continue with all the developments of the kindergarten, the library project by Matt. Architects are very nice, very, very subtle. The sustainability projects that are there for food and for energy. So, and all together is what they want to be. That is what we want to be. 1700 offers, 1700 programs, 1700 interpretations, and that leads to this. So what's next then? So you communicate then, in this next hutong, that in a kind of film that we are now making, where you, where in a way this hutong describes itself through all this interpretation that I just presented. And it becomes like, okay, filmic. Second thing is, of course, to communicate with people, to advertise it. So we made this lanterns, for every house that you can see from below, where you can see how a house would look like and what kind of would be lifted. This helped so much, that I will show you, because somehow even the extreme ones were like adored and loved by the president, because after CCTV he wants to have something Chinese, and this he gets some, a combination of the two, and that's what he wants. So here, hanging on the streets, invited people, and you can, and of course the leaders in China, and celebrate that moment and to advertise it. So then we could, the money was there to make the office, to start with the first street in that way, and select two projects for that, a couple of projects to build in the street. So I show you one, the mirror house. Yes, it's there. Almost. It's on the, here it comes. So it looks like this. It's this spot. There it's divided, and here how we could do it in that way. How it starts to imagine this kind of sceneries as such with Jensen. Not too much on the outside, of course,
So what's the next? Of course, how to do it in a Chinese way. So here are the stops that you find inside the woods that we do. And then with this guy, no mask, to work on that. But he's cool. He really makes this kind of beauty, assembly. With that, this is wood that petrifies by the spraying act in that way. And it stays like this. And that turns into this kind of bricks on that way. Wow. I wish that Amsterdam would have looked like that, is what it wants to say. I'll come back to that later, in that way. So this is, and then here's on the production, and how the stones are now carried out. So what's next? The casting house. Another one that we lost from one of the artists that has done this before, and that we try to imagine what can we do in this kind of circumstances. This spot looks like this at the moment. What can we do? So the concept is to rebuild the old houses, simply in a kind of cheap wood, and then to cut it on the side, then to pour concrete over it, like buri, in a way. And then even more and more in that way, and then it's stable. And then we can get rid of the houses below by burning them and finish it. So that would look like that at that moment. So what is the first message that you would see at that moment? That when you come from Mao the next time, and around the corner, you see this memory of the old houses that were there on that spot. And they become rooms where even you can look down to the cellar and float over this. The Chinese earth is what it wants to say. So this shows, and this is the project where it is now going, what you were doing also in Rome or here in the town, and then to turn it into something which is visible, which is experimental also, which makes it vivid, which gives energy and beauty in a very wide way, is what this wants to say, this project. And now I'm going to bring you back to Europe. Let's bring to that here. Because we can learn from Beijing. And I take you to Schengen. Schengen is my hometown. You don't know it, but that's okay. I lived there for 18 years. And my hometown was very ugly. And it's my parents lived there, my friends lived there, don't worry. And it was bombarded by the Americans just before it was liberated. So what can we do in that spot? I was angry. I didn't like to live there, but I loved the people. What can I do? I wrote a letter when I was 18. I said to the mayor, "Mayor, this is horrendous. But can't we do something about it? Can't we invite some architects to speculate on it?" And the mayor was very nice. He wrote a letter back and he said, "Mr. Maas, very nice idea. I will come back to you." That took 30 years. And what was that next? Now you made a market home. What can we do? Well, look at it. What is this? This is the old plan, the bombardment. Wow. How it looked. The Americans and the Dutch designers. Horrible plaza. What to do. But when this was the old situation, and this the bombardment and the post-war elements, and they said, "What would you like to propose? I want to have attention." I said, "Ooh, vanity." And what to do then? He said, "I can give you a skyscraper, and you have a..." I love mayors that love skyscrapers. Especially the ambitious. But anyway, you can see it from Antwerp, you can see it from Brussels, you can see it from Amsterdam, 400 meter high. And they took a team for a year on that, and they went to talk about, can I tell the elderman? Was that? In the end, no. One elderman had to go, and another one was fired. And so we have to, no. So anyway, maybe Mr. Maas, maybe he give you the last chance. And now you have to come up with a proposal that we all love. How to do that? You have to talk with all the politicians. There are in the Netherlands, there are 20 parties. Huh? So it's very simple. So they're here on the row. And what to do then? Huh? If you talk with you, what do you want? You say, and they say, "I want some of this." But you say, and you say, "Okay, fair, somewhere in depth." And you can also be with the depth, huh? Same thing, compared to you. No, like this. And height, the same as the neighbor, basically. Yeah. But give some light to the street, because otherwise the streets are dark. So it was very funny, after say, talking three times with them, and three evenings, what it ended up. So then you get this. That was like, it is very Freudian, I will show you. because this city, this village, looks like this everywhere. Because they have hundreds of the same in the bay. So we start to analyze all what they share and to understand all these dots and make pictures of it, map it, show it, and then turn it into knowledge. So many doors, so high, so much this, so much brick, so much that, and well calculated. And then in the end, we have the average farm, the average house. Interesting to see, it's half of the volume that they wanted. So I took the chance immediately to pump it up. So that would mean that you have a farm with a door like this, like Calimero, and it's like what it wants to be. And the mayor said, "Are you serious? Or is this ironic?" What can I tell you? This is politicians that have chosen it. And he told me, "Okay, this is now, from now on, it's serious. I accept this self-criticism, this irony in the day, but you have to give me classical material." What's classical material? Now, bricks and straw, tiles, and glass. Yeah, glass was also a problem. So we did that, you see it happening. Windows, there's completely out of glass at the moment. So we made with a photographer an interpretation of the average. We photographed all the farms, blended it in our computers, put extra information in it, and burned it with Japanese technology into the glass at that moment. And that's all. So it becomes an architecture of 2 millimeters. Some of you hate me for that, because that's a better answer to Venturi ever has made, I would say. So here, technology makes also that all the panels have to be choreographed. We have to make all nice render farms everywhere. We have to print it on time and to coordinate that. But the interior, of course, everywhere is the house. Everywhere is the average of Steinbrück. And even the kitchens are connected to that. I can wash my hands and I'm still in that environment, if I want to say. Even bad interior architecture doesn't count anymore. You are overwhelmed by, hopefully, this trompe-l'oeil, this picture, and this rose window that's over there. And of course, it's opened up, and the combination of small and big is hilarious, and the doors, and how we can imagine that even the commerce is participating in that, that the puppets react on the window in a way, and how the doors are made in that way, very thin. And this is, I think, my favorite image of Schengel. Somehow between new and old, it's evaporating or emerging, depends on your direction, and how we witness and look to it. How even this man with his bald hair becomes very attractive, I would say, and gets a point of theater and experience. But of course, in the evening, what happens then? You know, it becomes the lantern of the village. And somehow, it turns into a pride object at the moment. And now they love it. And now, yes, what's next in that way? You make a it's a responsibility act. You say, give something which everyone, all the politicians, were very democratic, was have chosen in a way, and was in a way the like the Trojan horse of newness. Yes, then there was some attention on the press, on the world press, and our mayor had to learn English. He didn't speak a word of it, so that and that it has now kind of happening. The mayor of Amsterdam came, and he liked the building. I go to the south. There's something happening there. There's a glass building, and they tell me it's nice. And he said, "I want to have something like that." He came back. So my mayor was very proud. Amsterdam is coming and to get ready. So what is happening here? This is the shopping street called PC Hoofd. And it looks like this at the moment. This is our, say, Champs-Élysées. It's the Netherlands. So what to do? It used to be a former street like that, very domestic. It turned in the 50s into something still in housing. And then the first companies came, the Gucci's, the Zara's, they came in to get pieces. Very cute and small still, how that would work. What happens with the museums, the Stedelijke Rijks and others around it, that a lot of people are coming, more Chinese, more Russians than ever. And what to have to facilitate, and how Prada can now build their grand store, and how Gucci can do that, is the question what it refers to. And they all want to do something like this, to be transparent, say global, bling bling in a way, and on the other hand, local. How to combine these two? That is the formula, which I like, and to do something in that. So what can we do with these two guys here? This is where the data is sitting. We looked at the old drawings, and that was like this. It became that this in the 50s, with the, and then this is the architect of Chanel, not Alena, was showing. And he said, man, how can you do that? He came from New York, and he thought it was, this was like the vernacular Amsterdam new style, where he interpreted modernity with context. He learned from you. And so what to do, what to do there? So he said, do this. Huh? So this is the drawing we gave to the beauty committee, and he said, wow, cool idea. Just pump up the, like a scandal, the existing in that way, and make it good. Okay. Yeah, so we do it only when we do it with this. Can we, because then you can do this. Then we can make a crystal house with deep gutters like this, with tiles like this. This would be fantastic. Mayer loved it. Better than scandal, he said. That's cool. And it is a kind of a dream to make it, say, but this is the Vondel part, that we do something like this in between, in a way. So, and then can advertise obviously itself in the evening. But what's next? The beauty committee said no. Beauty committees are fantastic, I think. That's what is beauty? That's the discussion. And they're very strong in the Netherlands. They say, no, no, you are, it's a very nice design, but it should be a normal brick. They go, what? But the mayor acted, no, 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 this is our law, normal brick. But how much, that I asked. They don't know. So we calculated all the brick in the surroundings in that way, 1 kilometer distance. And then the average amount of brick is 20%. So, okay, what happened then? If we apply the generic rule, what you want to apply on this, so you know already what's happening. You see your face. So this is what we want, this is what they wanted, and they get this. So that's all. So yes, this. And that has been translated now. It's one of the most expensive details. I'll come back to that, what has happened with this Chanel store. So what is that? Yeah, then you go to Italy, of course. Because who can do it? And you go to Venice, to Verano, and you ask with this family, the brilliant family, and they say, can you do it for us? Oh, no problem. Ages it took. Make one stone. 3 weeks later, it comes to the Netherlands, and I go, hey, Luigi, you have to speed up. No, it starts. So here they come. And we have to test how that will work, that it goes like this. So two of your dentists here in Italy came to the Netherlands, orthodontist, because they have the best glue. When you make it brown, then it glues the best. So that's, you see them, and how they are testing it with these machines, how we put it on the, in the labs, and to test it, yeah, the brass come out, it's positive. So it's stronger than even a hammer, or other terrible people. If they go there into this facade, no crack at all is what it's going to be. Your glass is magnificent, but your dentist are better, is what it wants to say. So what to do, you calculate the forces, you need some extra columns in it, so here you see how it's produced, how they are tested, and that way, yeah, it works. No red. The wood, now it's under production, with all the other wooden elements and the beams, of course. You see the wood, how it's coming across. The beams, separate issue, how to make that red zones, alarm. So we have to develop them separately into the kind of these elements that now are like melted together into one element as such. And then, of course, the most expensive detail, how to make bricks into glass. Impossible. So we have to infiltrate completely the brick with glass in order to make that glue possible. And then what's next? Here I go to the site, you see it happening, we start with the bricks, then we start to blend it up with our dentist there, with the two guys that are there. And then you see my favorite one. Because how to train people that somehow makes concrete normally. How to train them that they love glass. And every stone takes an hour and a half of keeping it like a monk to do that and to touch it with your fat fingers to do that in that way. That I think is the beauty of the project. And in this case also again the Italian dentist helped to form a good team with these people and to turn it into this kind of gentle move into it's the softest building that we ever have made. It took more than a year and a half to build it. My client was in panic.
pressure. And then you rent temporary another place. But somehow we were in love. And we started to consider this as a potential. So here it happens. Now the first thing that appears, how gradually is under development, and now somehow it becomes this kind of ice almost, that is permanently there, and that's stronger than ice, where you can probably see how the bricks glowed in, and how it turns into this plane, how gradually is there. So I invite you for the opening next Monday, to be there, and to have a good drink with us, and to see how it's now in reality. This is a starting point. As I said before with the research, next step, what is that? So I propose now to Chanel to make a new song and to say, because the interior is horrendous, you will see, but like a scandal, it doesn't matter. So what to do then? So could we imagine a shop where the products are better, where you can see it more closely in it? So we are aiming to make this, to make an environment which is, where you continue with transparency. Beautifully done already through some of your designers in your country, but it can be even more. If the floors are out of that, if the ceiling is out of that, if the walls are out of that, the neighbor also, again, look to that way, to a position in Asia, where you can watch the mountains in that moment. And then I can make the furniture like that, and I can make even the toilets like that. But where does this end? Where intimacy begins in that way? So you see it here, everything was intimate, we clad it with mirrors in there. So your clothes are doing that, and then boop, it goes like this, the image, like beyond it. And that makes it, I think, even continuous. And of course we continue with design, we want to have cars like that, we want to have kitchens like that. In the next Biennale, I'm going to show you the glass kitchen that we are making at the moment. I'm not allowed to show it today, but I raise a little bit that test where food is shown in the best way. Processing food is there. And you can see it in every detail, in a glass pipe, in a glass refrigerator, in a glass boiling act, in a way. Because it's all the food that counts, not the stuff that we are making. And not that. So how to do that is what this question, and hopefully leads to a momentum that density, I was talking about it, is combined with infinity, anyway. That somehow we can look further away is what it wants to be. Now, then I end now. And over the last, say, the sixth chapter of today's exercise is, of course, with my current hometown, with Rotterdam, with the exhibition that that people had organized last time in, and where I want to take you, of course, to maybe the other method of making this infinity possible. This is the site, you might have visited, you might have known it. But I want to tell you the story. I want to explain why it is as it is, and what is the simplicity or the complexity in it. It is used to be the site in Rotterdam. And then of course this happened in the war, flattened out the site exactly there. And we replaced it with buildings like this, with Maaskant, one of my favorite architects. And he made something, many of like this, which are very concrete, but they're good. They're really, really fantastic to do. And Rotterdam did make the choice to make a collection, maybe like Beijing, but in this case without theme. And actually the architects were intelligent enough to make proposals every time that reacted nicely on the former one, without rule in that way. And that leads to this kind of collection of elements. They're not bad, honestly. They're quite cool. And they have different cultures and backgrounds. And different, say, usages as such. So what would be the next step in this operation? And we were brought to this site, this bombardment zone, where the new buildings are appearing. We said, can we make not more higher buildings around this plaza with the same proportions as in Siena? Again, reference Italy. I'm going to make this exhibition in the future, because it is true that you build up a very good collection of references. But somehow you just continue, fair. But let's discuss that later. So that's the Siena thing and how it could be. And then we say, the mayor said, okay, a market hall. But how to do that? And my client, two investors, were like saying, we make houses, 250 and they pay for the market hall. And we do something like Mirai's in
in Barcelona, very small. And I said, man, you don't do that because you want to advertise food. You want to advertise food production. You want to, this is the first market hall in the Netherlands. We have no culture about market halls. We go to France, we go to Spain, and we love food. But how to do that then in this case? We have to say, why don't we twist the guy in that way? Like in Torino, okay? So that's to learn from that. And then to have, to use your housing to cover it, basically. This is much too expensive. Said, no, no, they have more penthouses than everywhere. So you can sell it easily.
Yeah, but this, they have no view.
Okay, make a view like this. Yeah, but then this is too expensive. I need too much steel to pay it off. And the rent should be low because it's social and middle class houses. Okay, wait. The Roman technology comes into it. Just the vault that makes it very high lifts. I got a big lift here. So, okay, no, puts it back and then it's done. And then the key, of course, is this structural diagram. Because the Netherlands is constructed with tunnels. Tunnel, we make a tunnel, it's a house, pour concrete over it, get a tunnel out, put it back. And we make concrete which is 25 centimeters deep. I go from XS to XL, don't worry. 25 centimeters, why? Because I only need 14 centimeters for the wall. No, that's for acoustics, because I don't want to hear my neighbor, is what it says. But exactly these 11 centimeters extra, I can do this. I can put the tunnel out and put it a little bit further away. And I can use that extra to kiss. And that is what it then suddenly happened to do. A rough structure which didn't cost more, which was paid by the housing. And I have to do that because the tomatoes inside need to be the same price as outside. It is, Rotterdam is not posh. It is not Milan. We are like a kind of workers' class, Birmingham environment. So what can we do? So we cladded it with the tiles of the city, the same pavement goes over, so it becomes more pop, I would say. And we go further into the detail, and we work with Philips for a while on a kind of LCD facade. Any message can be done. Fruit can come, fall over you, or you can have cathedrals of spaces. You can think about messages, the bananas are there, cheaper than there. Where is Dennis? Where are the parents of Dennis? All these kind of things were. So we worked a long time, 6 years ago, with Philips to get it in price. From 30, they promised 35 million going down to more or less 4 or 5. Didn't work out. So at just before the starting of the construction, we had to change it. And I'll show you what we did. A bit of nice. The dream was also to open the windows, so that you live behind the screen. You know this film? And that you are living behind the Coca-Cola advertisement. This gives a kind of character in that way. But then you open Coca-Cola, the O is away, or the C is away, and then you can shout to your son downstairs, hey, come on man, we need to eat, get the fish up. So that is what is, this is architecture. That is not like a museum, or like a little bit elitist environment. This is working with people in that way. But in such a way that it can be also iconic. Is it doable? Is it, can you live in an icon? Or do we only live in modesty? No. I think in this case, modesty would not have worked in the end where I look at it. So what happened? Did you see what we did? We placed the building away, school away, we made a basement and then started to construct at that moment and made this kind of touching of the tunnels up to this moment. That is what it wants to be. At that moment, there happened something. Somehow, the world started to discover what was going on in Rotterdam. So they put it on the news, come to Rafa, our lovely title, and say, oh, there's something happening where they expect that there were going more visitors. They expected 50,000 extra to come and to come back to that. So, and they put it already in some lists to do that, and still the market hall in completion. So what's next? Of course our queen is wonderful. And she said, I want to come. I want to shop, I want to open the building. That is, so wow, that is super that she's coming. So here we had fun and talked about the building with each other. She did a marvelous opening act, almost like Cinderella, and that was, and walked around with the people. And then of course what happening outside. That was the moment, which was touching to me. And when he opened the doors, then this happened. Here, somehow, something went wrong in our design. Something, the firemen alarmed and were panicking. And at 10 o'clock in the evening, closed the building.
and we have to repair all the fire exhausters, all the door handles, like overnight, to make this, instead of this small group of visitors, to have this almost this Walt Disney effect that happened with it. Same amount of people working there as in Euro Disney at the moment. And that I was starting to look at to this like this, shopping around, hanging out on the terraces, and this is also not bad, but in different people. And with Herman Black, a very good cook, he wanted to cook there, he wanted to slaughter oxes, so blood is going over the floors, and how to make marble, travertin, you know, you're a specialist, to turn that into blood-protected areas. Now, that is, took another way to go, but it's there, with the different users that that we have now, the different market people, what they do, and how we somehow celebrate also the next level. So, a market hall should be indeed, yes, minimum 60% should be for food selling, a maximum 40% for gourmet and but you see the market halls in Copenhagen and in Munich that are terrible, that are elitist places at the moment. Party poopers only go there and not you go to shop there. Of course they're surrounded by this. And that is why the second layer, at that moment only three terraces, now 10, 15 are coming now over it to make this second layer possible. And then, of course it's covered now with this. Two stories. But what can we replace Philips? Samsung? No, didn't work out. So we made with panels, we used Scangle again. We burned the technique into aluminum, similarly in Japan, to do it rapidly. We got a good price. We had a discussion, what the client said, can you give me an image? I said, what? Yeah, you can bring it from the internet. I said, there's 11,000 square meters of picture, if it takes something from the internet, then you don't see what it is. The pixel sizes are bigger than the panels. So that's stupid. Oh, but what do we have to do? We have to get render farms as rapid as possible over the planet. Toronto, Auckland, they were all working on this in 2-3 months to do it. Now get an artist to do that. A competition between artists. Artist, art. For a developer that has no taste, what can you do? So, and ultimately, we brought it into this man has made his perspective. We sent the group to Roma, to the San Lorenzo, to sit down for a while and to look at your beautiful trunk line in a day and say, that's what we want to do. Maybe in a pop way, maybe with shrimps or with bananas, and you live behind the shrimp. And the second element of this what support is the window. But for now, I can look to people that live there, that go to a bathroom or to a toilet and that have dinners over there. That explains then the vulnerability of that. So that's what, this is the most important part of the building. That I can look down at three layers of glass, no smell in it. And 250 people that say to the developer, you can't change what you're doing there. They protect and turn it into a public, if not collective space, is what they are doing through. And then you sleep next to it. You have this kind of paintings in your room. You have this kind of backdrop of your dining table or your backdrop of your working spaces. You love to watch even from the entrance halls and have this always, gratuitly, this is your address. And with even with furniture, what is this? This is middle class, lower middle class in Rotterdam. What you can do, but they are proud on what they have here and how you can look down on the market hall and how your children can play on 40 meter high, and now somehow danger is accompanied with comfort and that's the vulnerability that is symbolized in this project. And ultimately this window is the most important, because that creates urban space before it. That is heated during day and night, somehow. And when this cold city of Rotterdam suddenly becomes warmer and has this kind of usage, is what it wants to say. This picture point is then the result. And it's a bent. What can we learn from it? It's a bent building, a skyscraper. It's a porous building, in the best, and hopefully in the same way I explained with the porous city, that is now not a high rise, but density that's combined with openness. And what's the next to end with? Of course, this went over the planet, with this kind of images over there, with this kind of amount of visitors and control ads that we have to do, getting into lists, getting into the guidebooks. I didn't expect that at all, to be honest. You never can expect that. And what is next? I think this is what touches me more. That Rotterdammers use it now. Hey, Turkish weddings are at that spot. That the marathon is there. And that teachers, and it says, saying this is possibly made by teachers like you.
about the center, in the campaign of social affairs. That is what this building somehow has to demonstrate. Okay, Jamie is also in, no problem in that. But of course, and now it's reaching further in its destinations. And with that, I hope that I gave you a series of thoughts on what architecture can do with the city, why this is rather managed, and why it worked in that place, and why therefore it gave something to that city. I did it with architecture, I did it with urbanism, and I did it with research. And that leads hopefully to a next city generation with this great wishes. And with that, I hope to see you soon again.
Ringrazio Vini che ha fatto un nuovo taglio e ha introdotto un argomento che è legato molto alla nostra scuola, che è quello del design. Questo oggi mi ha dato la conferma come dire, della giustezza della identità che stiamo provando a dare alla nostra scuola, che è una scuola di architettura e design. Ancora non è integrata come noi vorremmo, però la strada è questa e oggi mi sono sentito rassicurata su questa cosa, prima cosa. Seconda cosa, io quando stavamo prima che venisse, stavamo a prendere il caffè al bar, io ho detto, ci abbiamo anche dei laboratori. La prima cosa che mi ha detto, andiamo a vedere questi laboratori. Sono dei laboratori in via di costruzione e quindi mi è nata una preoccupazione perché sapendo quello che avrebbe fatto vedere, le centinaia di plastici che si potrebbero fare da noi, ma è l'intuizione che noi abbiamo avuto come scuola di attrezzare la nostra scuola con questi laboratori e anche abbiamo un piccolo robot in un altro laboratorio che non ti ho fatto vedere di automazione e robotica. Sono ancora degli oggetti che noi abbiamo lì, spazi, perché stiamo costruendo appunto questa forte identità, cioè abbiamo il laboratorio di energetica, di diagnosi strutturale e quant'altro, proprio perché io credo che oggi lui abbia dato la dimostrazione che cos'è un architetto, che è trasversale e quando lui dice in ogni cosa, dopo che propone la sua forma, abbiamo studiato, abbiamo verificato e c'è una scienza enorme dietro a queste proposte, perché altrimenti non sarebbero potuto esserci questo tipo di proposte. Quindi, Pippo, credo che stiamo andando sulla strada giusta con la nostra scuola e la mia raccomandazione.
We need you understood, sorry, questions, but thanks for two main things. First, I mean, you know, Italy only 15 years ago separated the curriculums of architects and designers. We're somehow trying to keep them together, and the fact that you show some design projects so integrated with your architecture ideas is for us a great gratification, because it confirms on the way that the school is trying to engage. The second was how important it is to integrate the science, the robots, the labs, the investigation research devices in the work of the school. Facciamo un po' di
domande. L'ultima cosa, ieri alla conferenza lui ha finito dicendo vi piacciono queste cose, mi date un giudizio su queste cose, che ne pensate? E quindi credo che possiamo fare la domanda. Io un mio giudizio lo do. È un po'. No, aspetta, no, non me l'ha chiesto però io lo voglio dare, però se può tradurre gentilmente in un secondo, un momento. Allora, io dico una piccola eresia, per me questi sono degli edifici classici, nel vero senso, che hanno lo stesso valore degli edifici che vediamo nei libri di storia e che hanno rotto delle epoche. Quelli rinascimentali rispetto al Medioevo, quelli del Manierismo rispetto al Rinascimento e via di seguito. E l'altro giudizio che voglio dare è quello che ieri, stando a Roma e vicino a San Pietro, Io credo che chi ha visitato la Cappella Sistina per la prima volta entra e vede l'apparato decorativo, pittorico, secondo me avrà la stessa sensazione quando entrerà dentro Rotterdam, dentro Rotterdam. E anche qui il grado di innovazione con i nuovi apparati decorativi e dell'arte, che non c'era Michelangelo, ma c'è internet che potrebbe essere un Michelangelo super, ha ricostruito quella bellissima volta. Io la paragonerei alla Cappella Sistina.
Adesso per pareggiare al commento di Losco dovete impegnare, forse dovete fare dei complimenti ancora più importanti. Chi ha una domanda cattiva? Qualcuno ha una domanda cattiva, se no che gusto c'è?
Abbiamo detto, mi è piaciuto, che ne pensate, perché non si costruiscono queste cose in Italia?
There's a question here. Ce n'è una qua.
Okay. Really, congratulations. You put in several ideas of your ideal cities. Which could be the role of light in all this? Simple question.
But there are two types of light: natural light and artificial light. And of course, this has a reason to speak about. But light is light. It's leggero. So it makes it, and it's a material, of course, which you need and which helps enormously. Well, without that, I can't work, obviously. But I didn't show any piece of illumination in my lecture. So somehow I didn't need to explain it, or I did not show that it should be in such a way that you don't see it. That's the question. So that is light has its lightness, ultimately, and that it finds its path. And that's ultimately, of course, the art of light that we have to see. Why I don't see it as a subject? Because there are more important elements than light. There are more messages, there are more pieces of urbanism, but it helps, and it makes it more profound. So I'm not Bruno Taut, that is maybe like showing what the light could be, but on the other hand, I think when we can use it in this subtle manner, that we can, it can help us to advocate bigger urban agendas. Please. Time is finished, eh? Perfectly.
Last question.
Last question. Insegno ad alcuni di questi ragazzi tecnologia. Quanto del successo delle tue architetture è legato al saper fare degli artigiani, al conoscere i materiali, le tecnologie, e quanto ti relazioni con queste maestranze per far sì che le tue architetture siano poi così belle, efficienti e efficaci?
I think this is not a question. Is it a question or is it an observation? How I use craftsmen, I think that I try to do.
I mean, how do you work with your hands? And how much you still put... I mean, do you talk to the builder, to the construction people, how much you're close to the physical and the art, the craftsman part?
I hope that I showed, especially with the Chanel house, and also with the market hall, how much you have to put in to work with, in this case, the glassmakers, or in the case of the market hall, the printers. And you don't know how many tests have been made with the printing to get this perfect composition that can go through time in that way. So every designer has a lot of, say, needs a lot of energy with the specialists to make this possible. So, of course, these buildings also are in need for that, that costs also time. And maybe, Jan, you can calculate the amount of time we spend on this and to compare it with our fees. So that this makes also an illustration there. And on the other hand, you don't have to do that. Standard elements are also there. Per building, I can afford maybe one issue in the budget to do that. One zone, one panel, one piece of glass, and that's also a way of dealing with it. These specialists, as you were looking at, are only working on that component. to make that element. That's what you call it more a fort. Okay?
Nel 2007, un progetto di Ronara con la dedica finalizzata a ricordare questo incontro a nome di voi tutti. Grazie, grazie di nuovo.
Ringraziamo Vini ancora perché è stato bellissimo, ringraziamo Adolfo Muzzini e tutta l'organizzazione.